Hola, buenas tardes. Bueno, dentro del, como lo mencionaba Marcos, Marcus Mysen es un arquitecto alemán quien ha desarrollado proyectos de actividad urbana, pero relacionado mucho el vínculo de la participación como arquitectos con la sociedad. Estas experiencias han sido plasmadas en sus libros que están referenciados y traducidos a diferentes idiomas, y empezando por el libro Alguien dijo participar. Todo lo que se ha suscitado en la Ciudad de México como un proceso de madurez en la ciudadanía ha derivado en mayor participación, y unos de los que participamos y estamos obligados a participar más en torno a la ciudad y a lo que sucede en nuestro entorno o en nuestro vecindario, forma parte de nuestro quehacer y forma parte de nuestro involucramiento. Marcus Mysen es, como lo mencionaba, arquitecto, tiene su despacho desde hace varios años en Berlín y también es profesor invitado en la Universidad de Los Ángeles, UCA. Básicamente es la breve introducción.
Well, I want to thank Marcus for being here. Everybody speaks English, so I think we can do the presentation in English, mostly. Sometimes we have difficulties in speaking in English. But I'd like to welcome you to our school. It's important for us to have guest speakers like you, because this gives us a new dimension of what we're doing here and what is thought or being done elsewhere. I think that one of the most important features in your curriculum is that you are an international architect, because you are not American, you are German, but you studied in the UK, mostly in London, no? And I'll should read it in English, because I'm reading it in Spanish and translating it into English. Excuse me. You did your PhD at the Center of Research Architecture at Goldsmith London, and you initiated with this participation tetralogy, with the nightmare of participation. I think this just the title makes us think about what this can be, because nowadays we know that we can think of architecture without participation. In our country, that mostly 70% of the built environment is built by the people, we can think in other way than participation. And this means that we need a new and a different way to visualize the reality, and I think mostly what architects do. I think that the most important part is to have a critical spatial practice. Y eso pues todos lo saben, si no existe una actitud crítica, pues vivimos en la autocomplacencia. Y eso es lo que nos está pasando a los arquitectos, o sea, tenemos que generar una actitud crítica. So I'm very happy to have somebody with us that may have a critical practice and a critical view of what architecture is being, of the built environment is being done around the world, and that has this international experience, because sometimes we lose ourselves in this global world, and sometimes we need to look in our own space with a critical approach, and we lose these ideas through time. Sometimes our students look at the international scope in a different way than they look at their own reality, and I think that this would be very interesting for all of us. So I thank you very much for being here, but I think that you should take the microphone, not me.
Thank you very much for the invitation, and I think maybe we can just get started, and then, I mean, my idea was basically, first of all, hello to everyone. I'm very happy to be here. And especially, I have to say, I'm very happy for this kind of setting after kind of yesterday's setting, which I don't know if some of you maybe have been there, but it was very different because I was basically sitting on a stage where I couldn't see the audience. Like I was basically looking into black space because there was so much light. So I would actually very much like to invite you to ask questions also during the talk. So if you have questions, just shout and I'm going to stop and we can turn this into a proper conversation. I think this is much better than waiting until the very end and then, you know, just asking like two or three questions. So if there are questions, please ask. And maybe I just get started and then we see where this is taking us. Okay, so basically what I'm going to do today is, as opposed to yesterday, which unfortunately was a very short presentation, we have a little bit more time today. So I've decided to basically do two things. First, to give an introduction in terms of the more, let's say, theoretical framework of my work and what I've been working on in terms of my research over the last 10 years. And then I'm going to show you some projects from the studio that very much relate to this research work. But I'm also going to show you two projects which will take a bit longer to explain, but hopefully they will make very clear the kind of, let's say, relevance or the links between the research and the actual design work. So I know that it's maybe a little bit strange to make that distinction, and I'm not trying to say that there is a kind of general distinction between research and design work. Of course, it's very much linked. But I think what's important to say, especially today when quite often, you know, at architecture schools, there's this kind of weird split between theory and what's called practice. I would really like to emphasize that for me and hopefully for many others, that split no longer really exists. So what I'm starting with, what you can see here, is a graphic from my forthcoming book, which is called Crossbenching. And it's a quote actually from a German politician. Excuse me, I'm not convinced. And it's this politician called Joschka Fischer. And he used this sentence to approach Donald Rumsfeld in the context of the Iraq war. And it was a very interesting moment. And for me, it was a very special moment because this politician has a very interesting history, which relates a lot to some of the things that I'm going to say today. Because one of the things that I'm describing in my book is a kind of role that I've tried to design, so to speak, for the way that maybe architects should try to engage with the world surrounding us. And this role I call the uninvited outsider, meaning that it's someone who's actually not being particularly invited to engage with either a particular territory, a particular geography, or a particular set of contents. And what's interesting about this politician is that he basically, at the end of his kind of political career, he was the foreign minister of Germany, but he actually never got any high school degree, he never went to university. And he was actually one of the kind of leading figures during the 68 revolution in Germany. And you can see him, for example, on the top left image in one of the demonstrations. The next image, which is a couple of years later, he became the first minister of the and one of the founding members of the Green Party in Germany. And the third image is an image from one of the kind of party meetings where he was being accused to not go really kind of in terms of like party policy, being very conformist with the party policy. But I mean, the two images that really interest me here is the one on the left, where he basically has a kind of physical fight with a policeman in 68, and the image on the right, where he's basically disagreeing with Donald Rumsfeld. And for me, this is very interesting because if we look, for example, at the European kind of labor situation in terms of labor as a kind of political movement, the Labor Party. There's been a lot of debate about this idea of the slow march through the institution, this kind of Gramscian notion of the slow march through the institutions. And funnily, I mean, he's really the only person that I know who's done this. yet he's actually one of the most criticized people within the kind of like political arena, like the former political arena that actually has taken it to the stage. So this is just a little introduction in terms of maybe some of the things that I find relevant, which have more to do maybe with former politics, but also which have, of course, a relevance in terms of architectural or what I would rather refer to as critical spatial practice. And what I've done over the last 10 years was basically a kind of research project that was involved in with different questions regarding participation and more precisely kind of participatory practices. And I've done this basically through a set of four publications, which I understand as kind of like research material of this project, which then finally, in terms of a kind of thesis or a kind of actual proposition, ended up in this now forthcoming book, which is going to be presented in April, which is called Crossbenching. And so basically this consists of four books, which is this first one, which is called Did Someone Say Participate? Second one, which is called The Violence of Participation. The Nightmare of Participation, which was the kind of key work of this quadrilogy, you could say. And a last one, which is called Waking Up from the Nightmare of Participation. And so basically what I've tried to do with this tetralogy is to organize it as a kind of series of speeches, you could say. I mean, if you would kind of turn, kind of project this into the context of, let's say, the idea of kind of historic speeches, then it would really be the idea that the first one was a kind of prosecutor's opening speech, which is basically unpacking the subject and which is really posing the kind of central questions of the research project. The second one was a kind of book that asked a question but then kind of kicked it, so to speak. So it was really trying to figure out what was going on in terms of, let's say, contemporary spatial practices and how they're using or misusing the word participation and how to deal with this. And then in The Nightmare of Participation, what I've been doing was to actually propose an alternative and a kind of feedback loop with the fourth one, which is now actually turning into kind of like conclusive thesis, you could say. So it all started with this book, Did Someone Say Participate in Atlas of Spatial Practice, which is this one, which is also available or has been available for a couple of years in Spanish. And I'm going to give you a couple of insights from the projects that we've been addressing in this book. I mean, this is just a tiny kind of selection of projects that I'm going to talk about, but I think hopefully they will give a bit of an introduction as to the kind of thinking that we've been going through. This is an image that was taken off the Australian coast in international waters. And the vessel that you can see in the foreground, which is this one, has a container on board. And inside the container, it's an abortion clinic. And this is a project by a Dutch human rights activist called Rebecca Gompertz, who basically equipped this container with a fully functioning abortion clinic. But it was actually never carrying out an abortion. But it was a kind of, you could say, very smartly designed PR project, which was addressing the countries in which abortion is illegal. So in this case, Australia. And the whole point about this project was that the boat was supposed to enter territorial waters, go to the coast, pick up women that wanted to carry out an abortion, and then move again into international waters to carry out the abortion. And what you can see in the background, what you can see in the background is two Australian Navy vessels, which are basically stopping it from entering territorial waters. So you can see that there was actually a kind of like seriousness to the project. The second project that I briefly want to talk about is a project which was a project organized by UN Habitat in one of the northern regions of Iraq, in the Kurdish region. And basically the project consists of roughly 700 of these guys who are called D-miners. So basically they're slowly ridding the fields of mines, landmines. And what was very interesting for us about this practice, if you can use this word, was the idea that, you know, usually architecture is understood, at least, let's say, by a kind of general public, as a kind of practice of adding physical things to the world. So you come up, kind of brutally exaggerating, but you're coming up with a design, and there's someone carrying out the design physically, meaning they're gonna like stack things on top of each other. But what's happening here is actually very interesting, because this guy is creating kind of potentiality in terms of like future use of this particular site, of this particular ground, by actually removing something. So it's the exact opposite of kind of, let's say, traditional understanding of architecture as a kind of additive practice, but it's by removal in this case that you're actually creating potential for the future, and in this case, of course, to make it inhabitable land again. This is a drawing which is part of a larger project. The drawing has been created by Eyal Weitzman, who is an Israeli architect and theorist who's actually running the Center for Research Architecture at Goldsmiths in London, and who's been very much involved with a human rights organization in Israel called B'Tselem, who are looking at the way in which the Israeli military is using kind of strategic hilltops as a mode of like creating a kind of power structure over the territory of Palestinian land. So this is something that he refers to as the politics of verticality. But the reason why I'm showing this today is that we tend to think of, I mean, in architecture, we tend to think of drawing as a communication device, at least, let's say, historically or conventionally, between us as architects and the builders, who are the people who carry out the design. So in a way, it's a communication device like a telephone or other communication devices, but in the case of architecture, it's a visual one. Now what's happening here is that it's still a communication device, but in a very interesting way, actually not talking to people within the larger profession or within the larger field, but it's actually a communication device between someone who happens to have an architectural background and therefore knows how to master the skill of drawing, but using the skill of drawing not to talk between, for example, the architect and the builder, but the architect and politicians. So at this scale or at this project, it actually became so serious that at some point and through like many years of research, this material was actually being used by the United Nations as reference material for the conflict. This is a, maybe some of you actually know these little structures. This is a project by a Mexican artist called Mauricio Gillen, who at the time when we were working on the book was living in London. And he was doing this wonderful kind of photographic mapping, you could say, of a series of buildings and these kind of security structures that are supposed to secure the buildings behind them. And one of the things that he was very much interested in was how these kind of small-scale kiosk-like structures are actually mimicking the architectural language of the kind of mother building, so to speak, that they're supposed to secure. This is a photograph, which is part of a series of photographs that were looking at the Davos World Economic Summit in Switzerland by an artist called Armin Linke, who's mainly working with photography and film. And what he tried to do with this specific work was to unpack the kind of complexity of this tiny Swiss mountain village and the way in which it's being turned into a kind of like totally militarized fortress during the week of the World Economic Summit, which takes place there every year. So What I'm trying to get at here is that, I mean, I'm showing projects which probably to most people would not necessarily strike one as particularly architectural or particularly designy, one could say. But what really interests me is this question of how one can think of participation in architecture or any kind of related disciplines, maybe not from the point of view of necessarily total inclusion, which of course would be the historic or conventional understanding of architecture, which ultimately it's, I mean, if you wanted to create some kind of image of participation in terms of a kind of historic content context, it would probably be the round table, right? Like the space where people meet to discuss and to come to some kind of consensual agreement. Now, what was really striking for me was that, especially in the second half of the 90s and the early 00s, all of a sudden participation became this kind of buzzword, like, for example, also other buzzwords like sustainability and so on. And everyone was using it, and even in the media, it was like, you know, full-on kind of coverage. But one was kind of wondering, well, actually, what do they really mean by participation? Because it, I felt at least that they're using the word in different contexts, but nobody really knows what they're actually trying to say with it, and it's just a really kind of en vogue term. So this kind of question of, did we mean something else maybe, was really the starting point of an investigation, which then at the time when I was living in London, very quickly led me also into a kind of investigation into the current politics at the time, which was a very interesting moment in the UK, because it was really in the heydays of New Labour and Tony Blair. And what was very interesting about New Labour was that they totally managed to become kind of experts on PR and experts on kind of using particular buzzwords to create a particularly, let's say, comfortable situation for them. And participation was really one of those terms. So what was really kind of, or what I got really worried about at some point was this question of whether participation can actually also be misused in a really kind of terrible way, which is that it's being misused as a way to, you know, politically legitimize what you're doing, but to actually completely withdraw from responsibility. So to give an example, if I would now ask you, for example, to participate in a particular project that I'm interested in or that I'm working on, I'm of course giving you the feeling that you're very involved, but it's also quite unlikely in certain contexts that you, for whatever reason, are actually getting involved. So it's actually more like a gesture that I'm giving, and it's actually already knowing or anticipating that it's quite unlikely that you are actually going to participate, but it gives me a very kind of luxurious, or turns kind of my situation into a very luxurious one, because if finally I'm going to make a decision, I will always be able to claim that I've asked you to participate, and well, unfortunately you haven't, so now you're being kind of presented with the result. So what I've at that point tried to think about was kind of alternative modes of operation within this kind of, let's say, spectrum of participation, and thinking about how maybe this idea of a kind of romantic democratic involvement can also be kind of turned around, so that, and that's not me saying that any other form of participation is not valid or is not a kind of interesting approach, but for me personally what I was interested in was to think rather from the point of view of the individual rather than a kind of like group or kind of collective, and to think about how it's actually possible to, I mean, in other words, to empower myself to actually be in a position where I can participate in other kind of political contexts. So, because I think at the end of the day, if the individual is actually not willing to participate, and especially in architecture, if we as kind of practitioners don't assume also a political role, then I think we're in a kind of tricky situation. And that, of course, also has a lot of kind of relevance, or has a lot to do with the question of mandate. So meaning, are we actually doing something, or are we only doing things where we are invited to do something, or where we are commissioned to do something, or is there also a certain possibility for something that I would call a kind of self-initiated critical spatial practice? So kind of practice where not everything that we're doing is a kind of response to a question that's coming from the outside, but rather the opposite, where we as outsiders move into a different kind of political or spatial geography and work on certain questions that interest us, but hopefully have an effect on the public and, of course, therefore also public space. Which also brings me to the point of kind of consensus and consensus building and participation, which usually is the kind of core idea of participation, that at some point you try to unite these kind of different voices and come to some kind of agreement. But again, the opposite can also be very interesting, and this is something that, for example, is certainly kind of like driving force in my design work also, that I actually also believe that dissensus as the opposite of consensus, so kind of like more agonistic approach, you could say, to design, or in the more, let's say, general political sense, kind of conversational practice, can be a really productive mode of conflict. So in other words, not to understand conflict as something that's necessarily kind of a negative term or something that we should try to avoid, but rather something that, you know, we can actually cherish and think also about its kind of productive potential. Now, there's kind of three driving questions for this research. One was the question of responsibility and how to assume that. The question of authorship, and especially in architecture, what this means in terms of also collaborative practices. And when I refer to collaboration in this context, I'm not, I think there needs to be a very clear distinction between cooperation and collaboration, which is often, I think, misunderstood. So collaboration, I mean, historically, it's a kind of term that's coming from kind of, let's say, armed conflict terminology. So it refers to this idea of essentially working with the enemy or working with one enemy. So the typical example would be there's a kind of big enemy and there's smaller enemies. So in order to deal with the big enemy, it may be a good idea to kind of collaborate with the smaller energies to like join forces, so to speak. So the question, I mean, you could say that as an architect, that's what you're doing all the time, because it's very difficult to actually do something by yourself. But the question is it also possible that this already informs the design process? Because often what's happening in architecture is that, you know, we're doing the design and then we're starting to collaborate. But maybe this it's also interesting to address this kind of question already in the kind of process of design. And of course the question of agency, which is a very important one, because as architects, who do we represent? Or who do we think we represent? And what kind of effect or affect does that have in terms of our practice as designers and our practice as thinkers? And I'm sure you can come up with other kind of sub-practices of that kind of umbrella practice of architecture. and so there's a German word, Einmischung, which actually relates very much to what I'm trying to say here, and which also, to go back to this image that I started with of this politician who was like street fighting and later responding to Donald Rumsfeld. It's very much about this kind of idea of a proactive practice of getting involved and a kind of practicing as a productive irritant. So this is just a kind of, you know, what maybe you could refer to as a kind of silly image from an exhibition by a fantastic artist called Tobias Madison. And I thought this was a really fantastic image to describe this kind of idea of the move from the kind of like Obama-esque, yes, we can, to this kind of political rhetoric of the idea of mobilizing oneself in the sense of what I'm trying to describe within cross-benching. So here you see a couple of images which, from my point of view, all relate to some form of participatory practice. Of course, they're happening here in very different contexts and also, let's say, from the point of view of different disciplines. So there's some kind of, you know, architectural projects, some art projects, some kind of, let's say, contemporary artistic interventions, but also just kind of public protest. But the image that really interests me is this one, which is an image from the House of Lords in the UK, which I'm sure most of you are aware that this is a kind of very conservative political or formal political setting, as all the people that you see in this image are people that are only there either because of their family history or because the Queen, for whatever reason, has decided that they should be there. So it's a very strange kind of political assembly, but there's one particular section of this assembly that interests me, which is these guys, and they're called the crossbenchers. And the kind of physical structure that they're sitting on is called the crossbenchers. And they're interesting for me, I mean, as an analogy, of course, but they're interesting for me for two reasons. One is that the kind of physical setting, i.e. that they're sitting perpendicular to these guys, which is, you know, conservative fraction on one side and Labour fraction on the other. But not only are they sitting in the middle, creating this kind of like strange buffer zone, but also they are not representing any party, but they're only representing themselves, which is very interesting because that means also when they say something, whatever they say hasn't already gone through some kind of like intra-party consensus production, but it's actually something that they want to say. So again, I mean, please believe me, I'm not using this example because I'm a particular fan of the House of Lords and their kind of policies, but rather I'm using this as an analogy for this kind of question that I'm trying to pose regarding the practice of cross-benching. And here again, you can see a kind of abstracted drawing of the House of Lords with the crossbench section in the middle. So what I'm trying to get to is that actually crossbenching, to me, it can become a very kind of productive term and a kind of productive approach to, let's say, a more conflictual practice. But also what's quite important to understand is that, at least from my point of view as a kind of practice, it's not necessarily something that's supposed to solve problems. So when we think about kind of architecture or how architecture is often taught, it's a kind of like problem-solving exercise. So you look at a brief, and then I'm obviously over-exaggerating, but you get given a brief by a client, and then you're trying to solve the problems that the client is outlining. And what I'm much more interested in is the question of how, you know, maybe you can even produce more problems than there were before, but that these kind of micro problems that you create actually start a kind of productive dialogue, a kind of productive spatial dialogues between the users and the space, which is also something that's very kind of apparent in, for example, conflict theory. So there's a whole super interesting field when it comes to like international relations and international politics that's called conflict theory. And there the approach is also that, for example, a big conflict, you will never be able to address the conflict through, for example, conflict solving solutions, so to speak. But the most kind of productive way is to actually battle the conflict with micro conflict. So rather than trying to solve it, you create new micro conflicts that move the attention away from the kind of primary conflict. So what I would like to do is I would like to take you through a couple of projects that are part of a kind of umbrella, a larger umbrella project or a larger umbrella research project that you could say is happening or has been happening at the studio for the last 5 years. And it's something that we internally call Cultures of Assembly, which is a kind of mix, you could say, of certain research projects and certain design projects, sometimes with clients, sometimes self-initiated, and that are all, in one way or another, dealing with the question of how assembly can be understood as a kind of spatial grammar, and how that then can be exploited in terms of the implementation of zones of friction or the kind of conflict that I just mentioned earlier. So again, to go back to my favorite example of the kind of London formal political assemblies, here we see an image from not the House of Lords, but the House of Commons. And this, to me, it's really one of the kind of key images, at least that I can think of, when it comes to questions of kind of formal spatial assembly and how design can play a role in the kind of creation of kind of conflict, but conflict that becomes productive. So if you think about a kind of international political assemblies, and I'm going to quickly go to this image, you will find that, you know, most of these spaces have been designed in a way that, regardless of the political system or the political regime that they're supposed to represent, they're actually mostly spatially outlined in the same manner. That is to say, there's a very kind of clear, you know, understanding of a person standing in the front talking to an audience, and there's an audience sitting listening, and usually this kind of distance between, you know, the two of us, it's actually not so close, but it's actually much further. So for example, in the German parliament, the speaker is standing 12 meters from the first person sitting in the first row. And what's very interesting is that, of course, I mean, political debate also has a lot to do with kind of proximity and a kind of conversation between individuals. And so what I find very interesting here is that basically by implementing a very simple physical object, which is a table, which of course also in the case of the House of Commons, it's a very kind of choreographed object, which we don't have the time to go into now, but I mean, each of those objects, even that you can see on the table, has a very theatrical meaning to it. But what's really fantastic is that it's an idea of placing a physical object between two oppositional parties and also the two leaders of the opposition. So basically the idea is that if I'm speaking and the opposition leader disagrees, he or she gets up and starts addressing me directly, which of course creates a completely different kind of politics and culture of conversation than the kind of, let's say, general culture of formal political representation that we're used to. So this project was based on a kind of 3-year professorship that I was engaged in at the Städelschule in Frankfurt, where we were doing two research projects. One was called Cultures of Assembly and one which was called Stealth Architecture, and which looked at these kind of phenomenon as a global phenomenon, but also trying to really understand how kind of physical design can impact the way in which political conversations can take place. I'm very sorry for the quality of the drawing here. This is also a part of this investigation, which was looking particularly at the Occupy camps around the world at the time when they occurred. And one that particularly interested us was the one in Frankfurt, because it was very special as it was designed, so to speak, right outside the European Central Bank. And it had a lot of very interesting kind of design components to it, which, I mean, of course, they're very different from, let's say, a kind of formal or aestheticized understanding of design. But it was really about a kind of very pragmatic idea of design, which was basically how can we make sure that this camp will exist, which in this case was very difficult because it was on a public ground which was like co-owned by the European Central Bank. But basically, they finally managed to get hold of that site. And just to give you an example, so one of the things, or one of the policies that they were not allowed to break, was that the policymakers in Frankfurt basically told them that if they're putting up a tent, and if they're going to put a peg into the ground, like the moment that they're going to penetrate the ground with whatever kind of physical object, they have to leave. So basically, they created like an entire kind of new ground condition, which was made up of Euro pallets, you know, these kind of wooden pallets that you put kind of whatever kind of produce on. And then everything was tied to the palette, because this was taking place in the winter, which was also very good because there was a lot of snow and rain, so they could make sure that the tents would actually not touch the kind of real ground or the real soil. Another really interesting aspect was this document, which was the kind of policy through which they managed to actually implement the camp. One of the difficulties in Germany is that it's very easy to organize a demonstration, and because they're kind of very serious these days about, you know, producing a kind of democratic framework, almost anyone could actually organize a demonstration. So it doesn't matter if it's like far left, far right, if it's some kind of crazy group. If you want to do a demonstration, you can. You have to kind of write an official kind of letter. But there are also very strict limitations to what you can do. So for example, one of the things is that they're going to tell you like where you can walk, or for example, they're going to tell you how long it's going to take. So usually a demonstration should not take longer than 8 hours, which of course in the case of the Occupy camp would have been impossible because it was going on for 6 months. So basically they found like a legal loophole, which was very interesting, which it's in German it's called a Mahnwache. So a Mahnwache basically means if you think, for example, of I don't know, like Mao or Lenin, who are kind of let's say publicly visible in a mausoleum, this is in German this would be a form of Mahnwache, because basically what's happening is it's a kind of process of mourning. But there actually needs to be an end to the mourning, but it's very difficult to actually kind of precisely set the point when the mourning is over. So for example, in certain cultures, there's different ways of dealing with mourning, and sometimes there's even like very kind of formal attributes as to like when mourning should end. But the funny thing is that in Germany, there's a kind of very kind of pragmatic way of dealing with this, which is that the moment that the activity of mourning stops, and this is something that's very strange because nobody really knows what the activity of mourning really kind of entails. So, I mean, in a kind of superficial way, you could say, let's say if your mom dies, you're gonna cry, you're gonna be in a bad mood, like you're gonna be probably depressed for 6 months. But then what's gonna happen, and how is it possible for someone else to tell you that this process is over, so to speak? The same with this kind of more public form of mourning. It's very difficult to tell when it's over, of course, but this was what they used as the kind of loophole. So they basically said they're gonna organize it as a Mahnwache, which then in terms of policy or the police also, I mean, they couldn't do anything about this. But it also created a very interesting kind of side product, which was that, or kind of rather absurdity, which was that in the winter when it got super cold and some of the activities actually decreased at the camp, so there weren't so many lectures anymore, there were less people like doing activities and so on. At some point the police came to the camp and they told like the inhabitants of the camp that if they're not going to protest more, they have to leave. So it was a very kind of interestingly kind of designed structure or framework. And what I'm trying to say here is that of course, that's also something that as architects, you know, we have to be very aware of this, that a lot of the kind of physical realities around us are not actually being produced by what we consider kind of architectural design or spatial design, but it's created by policy, by policy making, by legal frameworks and certain protocols. But that's not to say that we cannot engage with those. So I'm very interested in how this kind of design of protocols and policy can also become a kind of productive part of the design process. Now, this is one of the photographs, also again by this artist called Armin Linke, of the Occupy camp in Frankfurt, and it's also the cover of the first book that we published as part of a book series that's called Critical Spatial Practice, which now we've actually just published the 8th edition. And so maybe to give you a bit more kind of insight into the way that I also understand this, what hopefully you don't misunderstand as a kind of polemic of this idea of the uninvited outsider, or the idea of, let's say, the architect or the kind of practitioner acting also as a kind of proactive individual and a proactive practitioner. I'm going to talk to you for a little while about a project that I've been organizing in the Middle East since 2007, which is called the Winter School Middle East. And in order for you to understand this, I have to tell you a kind of quick story about something that's not directly related, but had a huge effect on me in terms of why I came up with this idea for this project. So in 2007, I was invited to basically edit a book for a conference in Dubai, which was a very, very strange conference, which I'm going to tell you a little bit more about in a second. And there were basically two books commissioned for this conference. Almanac, which is the one that you see on the left, which is a publication by OMA and AMO, basically looking at the peninsula or the Gulf region, essentially from the air. So kind of like typical AMO kind of research project of understanding a kind of territory, let's say, from almost kind of satellite perspective. And so what we proposed then was to do the exact opposite, which was to understand the Gulf region and particularly the Emirates from the point of view of the street, but really by introducing kind of almost childlike typologies, which we would then address through one visual and one textual contribution per typology. So for example, some of these typologies were house, courtyard, street, market, these kind of very kind of simple typologies that, you know, my mom would understand, my grandma would understand, and most people on the street would understand. And then relate to this through kind of on the ground research. And so then we were thrown into this, which you can imagine is a bit strange to be there. And especially what we didn't know before was that that the whole audience, so if you would now turn the camera around, there was an audience of 800 people sitting there, and they all paid like $1,000 to be, like US dollars, to be there. So you can also imagine what this audience was like. So it was basically representatives of like multinational kind of architecture offices, these kind of architecture offices that you never see in publications because they just churn out, you know, 300, 400 buildings a year, and they have these kind of offices like somewhere in the middle of nowhere with like 5,000 employees. And they, of course, were very interested in this because they were hoping to get like commissions in different, you know, either architectural or urban realities in the Emirates. So this this panel that you see here was a very funny panel, I would say, because it was about kind of urban infrastructure, and it was very serious. And it was mostly, of course, about questions of kind of finance. And as I already mentioned, if you would have turned the camera perspective, there were 800 people sitting there listening very, very carefully. And then the next morning, when we presented the outcome of the research with Rem Koolhaas, Antonia Kava, who at the time was the editor of Bidoun magazine, now is director of Art Dubai, and well, this is me without hair, and then the fourth one is Stefano Bueri. There were 8 people in the audience. Yeah, so basically the audience was double the size of the panel. And so we got a little bit worried about this. But also what was very interesting for us was that basically every time that we went for like a cigarette break, the only place where you were allowed to smoke was in the courtyard, so you actually had to leave this kind of very posh hotel in which the conference took place. And so every time we walked into the courtyard, there were literally like 50 or 60 students, or like, let's say, I mean, kind of older teenagers or like, I don't know, people in their like early 20s, literally like rushing to us and bombarding us with questions. And the reason why they did this was because there was no way for them to actually participate in the event. I mean, A, because obviously they couldn't pay the $1,000, but also because the conference had a very kind of clear agenda in terms of like who was going to be invited and offered tickets and who wasn't. And because at this time I had already been engaged with the with this kind of particular geography for quite some time through different projects, and one thing that was always striking for me was that there are, of course, like there's a huge amount of kind of international academic institutions. So basically, like all the Ivy League universities, they have campuses in the Middle East, mostly in Dubai and Abu Dhabi. But they have a very strange policy, which is that it's basically kind of mimicking the home campus and also the curriculum that they're running there. And the reason why they're doing this is basically because after 9/11, a lot of families from the Middle East decided to no longer send their kids to the US. And this, of course, created a kind of financial drama for a lot of Ivy League schools, because this is like one of their kind of recruitment turfs, you could say. So they just decided, you know, if they're no longer going to come here, we're going to go there, which was what they did. But unfortunately, in terms of kind of like institutional setting that they created, it was very, let's say, far away from the kind of realities in which they placed these institutions. So there was almost no debate between the institutions that they placed and the kind of like local kind of cultural complexities. So one of the things that became clear was that it could be super interesting to start kind of implementing very small informal institutional structures to start to address some of these questions. So basically, when I went back to London, I started working on a kind of idea for what such a kind of institutional framework could be. And I decided that we were gonna, with a couple of friends, start a kind of initiative that we just kind of idiotically called the Winter School Middle East, which had also a particular reason why it's called the Winter School, because we thought the only way that you can really engage with the city is if you go there in the winter, because it's, you know, January and February are basically the months where you can move or walk on the street because it's not so hot. So you can actually really get a kind of different understanding of the city rather than just being in a kind of air-conditioned car. So the way that the Winter School was then set up was through kind of annual themes. And this image that you see here was an image of the first annual theme, which was on labor camps. So I'm sure that most of you are aware that there's a kind of quite serious situation in terms of the general labor politics in the Emirates, especially in Dubai. There's like hundreds of thousands of foreign kind of construction workers who have been exploited kind of heavily and who also have basically zero rights. And what was interesting for us was that this is obviously no news. I mean, this has been in like the international kind of daily news for like almost 15 years now. But what was interesting for me was that it's something that it's constantly being talked about, but it's constantly also being talked about in the very same way, which is basically through the lens of Western journalists, mostly kind of European and US American journalists, who mostly also haven't been there and who know very little about the situation, but who are constantly regurgitating the same arguments, which of course some of them are true, but some of them are also very naive. So it was our kind of ambition, let's say, to somehow undo some of these arguments, and rather than kind of constantly, I mean, today I guess you would say kind of shitstorming a kind of particular urban reality, you would actually go there and try to work around this problem by actually coming up with alternatives. So not just kind of critique that's going to end with the kind of words of the critic, but to really try to turn this into something productive and to come up with alternatives. So I mean, of course, we don't have the time now to go into all the little details, but to give you some example of how we've been working. This, for example, is one of the studios. I mean, we tend to have like each year around 60 students who can freely apply. There's no fees. With the way that we've organized it is that there's a couple of international NGOs who are supporting this financially. And the only thing that students have to pay for if they're not local students, usually the average is kind of like 50% students from the larger region, meaning including Iran, Iraq, North Africa, and 50%, roughly speaking, international. So we also had students from Mexico in the past, with students from Australia, Chile, some European students. But here, this particular studio, which was one in this year, which was the first year, it was one of six studios that were all looking at the umbrella term or investigating the umbrella term of the labor camp. This particular group was actually led by an architect, but also a novelist. And the way that they worked was that in 3 weeks, they did a set of 60 interviews with people throughout the social spectrum of Dubai. And what was very interesting there was that basically the studio kind of rewrote the brief, or the studio kind of interpreted the question of labor, not thinking about the labor camp as a kind of isolated phenomenon, but trying to understand the labor situation at large in Dubai. So they talked to, I mean, basically representatives of almost any kind of social group or social subgroup that you could imagine. So they were talking to Pakistani construction workers, they were talking to Russian prostitutes, they were talking to South Korean mobile phone dealers, they were talking to investment bankers working for HSBC that were just there for 2 years coming from the City of London. They were talking to kind of cultural representatives from other countries. But basically what was interesting in the end was, or one of the findings of this study was, that basically all of them are on like 3 year roaming contracts, and they can basically be chucked out at any one moment out of the country, which actually was very interesting because it didn't make their personal situation so different from the situation of the construction workers. We then also worked together with some of the, at least some of also very dodgy kind of construction companies who are responsible for the way that these, if we go back to this image, this area, this is just a tiny, tiny, tiny fraction of an area called Sunapur, which houses 80,000 construction workers. And so we also started like dialogues with some of the construction companies who have not only built these camps, but who are also the kind of employers of the laborers, trying to come up with kind of spatial alternatives to how they're kind of generally working on these camps and what this kind of reality means in terms of also kind of urban culture, because this, of course, you can imagine that these camps are located in parts of the city which are almost invisible. So they're trying to, of course, hide it from also tourists and other people who come to the city. So as I already mentioned, we've partnered up with a couple of institutions and NGOs to work on this further. And now I'm jumping ahead like 4 years. We've been also, to come back to the issue of cultures of assembly, we've been working on one annual project, which was very interesting for me personally because it's dealing with different types of formal and informal political assemblies, which is a phenomenon in Kuwait, where the winter school is located now, which is called Diwaniya, which is a kind of historic typology which goes back to the days when Kuwait and the kind of larger geography was mainly inhabited by nomadic tribes. And Diwaniya is basically a way to describe a space where different kind of tribal roots meet. And at the space where they meet, you set up tent. And historically, there was always one particularly male tent, which was used as a kind of assembly space, to exchange information, which of course at that time was kind of crucial. But what's very interesting is that this is something that has historically been developed and that has been carried through into kind of like contemporary urban reality, documentary film about these spaces. And so what you see here is something that if you would see this in a magazine, you would probably think of a coffee shop or a kind of tea house or, you know, fairly informal space where strangely only guys seem to meet. So there's no women. There's some guys, you know, playing PlayStation, smoking, and being on their mobile phones. But it's actually something that very much relates to something much more serious and also politically influential. So the space that you see here and the space that you see here are essentially, in a kind of political sense, the same spaces. It's just that this is a diwaniya, which is inside a kind of market hall, which basically anyone can walk into. And this is a diwaniya, which is owned by a fairly affluent family, which is attached to their private house, which is also historically the kind of typology that's normal, so to speak. So if we look into kind of regional typologies, also in terms of the way in which gender informs particular typologies, the courtyard in this region is always the space of the woman, and the diwaniya historically is the kind of male space, which also, I will tell you in a moment, has become something very important in a kind of political conflict situation. So here we see this space, and it has an outside space, which is this. And as you can tell, they're always arranged in a kind of similar manner, which is that the perimeter of the space is being used as a space to sit, so that essentially from any one point where you sit, you can see everyone else, but at the same time, you can create very intimate conversations, because you can meet, for example, you can sit there and there's someone sitting next to you with whom you're having a conversation, but the other people may be sitting here or there. So it's a kind of public space which can also be incredibly private, and it goes really excuse me, throughout all kind of social realities in Kuwait. So this, for example, is a diwaniya, which is in a refugee camp on the outskirts of the city. And the way that this works politically is exactly the same way. For example, this space works exactly the same way as this space. So it just has a different constituency. So the people who meet in those spaces basically discuss, like informally discuss current politics. And there's always one representative of that space who takes it up to the next kind of higher political level, so that it slowly trickles up to the kind of like formal political level in which those kind of decisions that are being taken on a kind of very local kind of scale actually make it all the way into parliament. And what was very interesting in these kind of spaces was the role of the women, because as I mentioned earlier, it's a space that's very heavily influenced by men. And so a couple of years ago, there was a kind of ambition that for the first time actually in Kuwaiti history of three female individuals who grouped up and tried to become representatives in parliament. And the way that they did this was to basically gate crash these male-dominated spaces. So they actually went from diwaniya to diwaniya to diwaniya to almost as a kind of like political action to present their kind of ideas, which you can imagine was almost like a kind of micro-revolution, because in like hundreds of years, there have been like very, very few women who ever stepped foot into those spaces. And one thing that was also very interesting in the making of the documentary film was that Zara, who unfortunately you can only see her back here, but she's the co-director of the Winter School. She's a Kuwaiti national. I mean, originally she's from Iran, but her parents fled when she was three. So she was the for the sake of the documentary, she acted as a kind of like translator or kind of moderator, you could say, because a lot of the locals that we interviewed, they didn't speak English. But what was, of course, very interesting was that whoever we wanted to speak to would have to speak to her first in order to start the conversation. So it also created a very interesting kind of gender dynamic in terms of those particular spaces. The project then resulted basically in three products. One was an exhibition. One thing I forgot was that the kind of research project was kind of partially financed by the Graduate School of Design at Harvard, and so the one of the kind of conditions, so to speak, was that we're going to do an exhibition in Cambridge, which was this one, and we also produced a kind of printed matter or kind of newspaper, which is called The Space of Consensus, which was also part of another exhibition at Storefront in New York, and we produced a book later about the subject. These are a couple of images from that very same year when we were dealing with Diwania, also in terms of how those spaces can be rethought as kind of spaces of physical design. And these are just a couple of images from the way that we work in these winter schools. I mean, it's a very kind of, let's say, a social kind of model. We're also, food is very important as a kind of, say, communication device, or cooking as a communication device. Okay, now we're going to make a big jump from the Middle East into kind of one of the old centers of West Germany, in inverted commas, which is Cologne. Cologne is a very interesting city because, I mean, it has a kind of, as a city, it has a history that goes all the way back to Roman times. I mean, basically when the Roman Empire extended northwards, and it was the basically the most important city north of the Alps. But it's also very interesting in terms of, let's say, the like German and European art history post-war, and was for many years like Germany's most important city in terms of art institutions, galleries, and also artistic production, which basically was stopped or came to sudden halt when the Berlin Wall fell, and a lot of artists moved from Cologne to Berlin. And then only a couple of years later, all the galleries followed, and now Cologne is has been kind of struck with this kind of apparently never-ending kind of sadness or depression, where they don't really know what they're doing in terms of their kind of art institutional reality. So one thing that really kind of contributed to this depression was a particular moment in the early 00s, when there was a political decision being made by the mayor of Cologne that this building, which is kind of very, or was a very kind of beautiful and very interesting brutalist structure, which was the Kunsthalle of Cologne. So just in case, maybe not all of you may be aware of what this typology of Kunsthalle really means. So in kind of opposition, let's say, to the typology of a museum, which has a collection, or a gallery, which deals with the kind of like commercial side of art, you could say. The idea of the Kunsthalle is it's a kind of like a German typology that was invented basically to use city money to showcase the artistic production of that particular city. So in the case of Cologne, the historic idea of the Kunsthalle was that it would you know, show the works that are being produced in the city. But it also, because it was a very important city, became a kind of center for German artistic production, and also to a certain extent European artistic production. So it has a very rich history of also people engaging with the institution, like in this case, on this image, Josef Beuys trying to force his way into the building during a kind of demonstration in Cologne in the late 70s. But then at some point, the mayor basically decided that the building was supposed to be knocked down and was supposed to be replaced by a kind of multi-purpose building that, I mean, you can probably already imagine what this would be like. And he basically said that the Kunsthalle would also get a space in that building, but that they couldn't, stay in the old one. Which then, as a result, created like a huge outrage in the kind of artistic communities in Europe. And there were series of events that tried to stop this from happening, but this didn't really work very well. And as you can see here, very shortly after, the building was knocked down. And the city was left with this kind of situation, which was literally a hole in the urban fabric. So as a result of this, a kind of foundation was started, which is called Das Loch, which in German literally means the hole. And they were trying to deal with the kind of political insanity of this project, because what happened was that once the mayor had knocked down the building, there was a press, once it was physically gone, he organized a press conference in which it was communicated that unfortunately the city just realized after going through the budget again that they don't have the money to build a new building. So this was the kind of new reality that the city was kind of dealing with. And as a result of this, a kind of imaginary institution or kind of non-physical institution was founded, which as a kind of working title was called European Kunsthalle, and which was really trying to understand the kind of current reality of, let's say, both architectural and artistic production in Europe and what this means in terms of institutional space or institution building. And so the way that I came into this was that basically after this institution was announced, there was a founding director, Nikolaus Schaffhausen, who then invited different people to work with different aspects of this kind of question. And so I was one of three people, together with Nikolaus Hirsch and Philipp Misselwitz, who were supposed to think the institution through kind of spatial questions, i.e. what does it mean today to actually run an institution in Europe? What does it mean in terms of the kind of spatial reality of an institution? Is it even necessary today as an institution to have a kind of representative building? What does this mean in terms of budgets and so on? And so for us, the kind of starting point of this like 2-year research project was to look at the kind of like current reality of architectural production when it comes to cultural institutions and to be faced with this, which it's kind of like the wet dream of international mayors and the kind of, we've probably reached a point where the heyday of exactly this, what we're seeing there, is over. But what I'm not trying to do here is to criticize individual buildings, or I'm not trying to criticize individual architects here for what they've done, but rather what I'm criticizing is a kind of international phenomena, which is also to a certain extent a kind of like post-Bilbao phenomena, which has to do with a kind of unquestioned production of large-scale architectural objects, which are supposed to represent cultural institutions, which are basically being drained in terms of their budget because they're creating these kind of architectural icons. This is one thing. The other thing is that actually what becomes very interesting the moment that you put it together like this is that they become almost replaceable because, of course, they're being designed as kind of like spatial, large-scale spatial sculptures. And you could, you could take one out and, plonk it into another context, and to be honest, it wouldn't really change the world. So the question for us was, what really happened after Bilbao, and why has this kind of created a situation in which we're now facing a kind of like ridiculous institutional reality where a lot of political decisions that are being made are only looking at the kind of representative character of the institution in terms of a kind of architectural envelope, but not at the kind of performability of the institution as a space of production. So we also did like a series of quite serious studies on kind of economic frameworks of institutions. And one of the things that we also came across is this kind of fantastic example from Sheffield in the UK, where Branson Coates architects designed a cultural center, which is the Center for Popular Culture and Music in Sheffield, which cost £52 million. And the very same day that it opened, it had to close because they used so much money for the architecture that they actually didn't have the money to program it. So the institution basically literally had to close, and now these spaces are being rented out to businesses. We also did, and this is just a kind of section of the kind of research that we developed over the 2 years, looked specifically into a selection of 20 art institutions across Europe that we identified for several reasons, partially because their kind of spatial model was very interesting, or because their financial model was very interesting. And for a kind of second part, or the second year of this research project, we proposed a way to work together with the city, which was basically by implementing what we called a kind of Trojan horse into the cultural administration of the city of Cologne, which is this kind of ugly building that you see there. And so we identified one space in there that was empty or that was kind of up for grabs, and we convinced them that we could get the space for 1 year for free to work with them, which was this. And of course, also the kind of underlying hypothesis there was that, or our kind of proposal, so to speak, was that all you need in order to run a kind of cultural or kind of art institution is internet, a coffee machine, and a fax machine, which basically were the kind of like three key elements that we put into the space. And in the first year when we were there, we basically produced two products. One was a 30-day-long symposium in the first year, and in the second year, a kind of decentrally organized exhibition all over the city center of Cologne. In the first year where we were organizing this this symposium, it was very interesting from the point of view of actually scattering kind of program or content units over the city center, but in spaces that would usually not be kind of dealing with, let's say, contemporary artistic production, but also trying to set up kind of strange relationships with what we called kind of other or alternative publics. Because of course, usually what happens in architecture or art is that the audience that we're dealing with is a very specific one. And so what we tried to do was to open this up also by choosing very kind of strange locations for kind of conferences or symposia. So for example, this image that you see on the bottom left is this kind of like very shady and kind of borderline dodgy business hotel in the center of the city. So we placed the speakers at a very kind of uncomfortable place, which meant that like all the people that came in to walk to the reception, they had to actually pass them. And there was a kind of certain kind of similar approach when it comes to these kind of implementation of kind of conflict zones, you could say, when it came to the actual exhibition, which took place the year later, which we called Models for Tomorrow, and which basically proposed a model of the institution which no longer relies on an actual kind of large-scale institutional space that will always remain kind of stable, but a system which, as a kind of institutional system, is highly unstable or unstable. So the only thing that would be a kind of fixed position in this kind of model would be that right in the center of this 1 mile circle was the Trojan horse. So this is where we kind of implemented this very small kind of administrative office. And then we drew a 1 mile radius, and within this circle we identified a series of 22 spaces that we call post-public spaces. So they're all spaces which they're neither public nor private, at least not in the kind of conventional understanding of the sense of the words, but rather they're these kind of spaces that, for example, quite often are privately owned, but can be used by the public in a kind of strange way. So for example, if you think of call centers or these places where, you know, you can get these call cards for, I don't know, €2, and then you can call your family, for example, in North Africa. Or we basically had, of each kind of like major religion, we used like one kind of representative typology as an exhibition space. So we had like a Roman Catholic church, a synagogue, a mosque, but we also had like one of the spaces was like the reception area of a brothel. There were all sorts of kind of weird spaces that you would take the kind of audience of the exhibition through. So to give you a couple of ideas of how this worked was that each artist was basically assigned one of these spaces, and each artist then produced a site-specific work. And the way that you would move through the city was with this kind of little guidebook that was distributed in a really kind of interesting manner, because we managed to get a deal with one of the kind of magazines and newspapers in the city that have a reach of 800,000. So basically everyone locally had or was able to get like one of these kind of guides, but also there was a huge international audience for the show, which then basically slowly moved through the city experiencing all these different works. So in this case, it's a kind of petrol station, which is also a very good example of this, what we refer to as this kind of like post-public condition. And here you see a work by Dutch collective Big Thunderpool. This is a Lawrence Wiener piece at the Central Train Station in Cologne. This was very interesting, maybe to explain this idea again of like how conflict can become a kind of methodology in designing those kind of spaces. So this is a Catholic church, and one thing that was very important in the design of the European Kunsthalle was that each exhibition relied on a very specific time code. So for example, here we had 22 spaces, but the 22 spaces were not all open at the same time, but they had very specific kind of time frames to which would relate to the content of the space. So here, for example, in Germany, it's the kind of typical kind of Catholic, Roman Catholic mass on Sunday would take place at like 10 a.m. So basically we decided that for this particular venue, the time frame for the exhibition would only be from Sunday 10 to 11 a.m. And the actual venue within the church was the office of the priest, which was on the second floor, which you could only enter through a little staircase that you actually had to walk through the main space of the church. Now imagine a kind of international art audience that walks through a kind of, you know, mass in motion in 1 hour through this church and constantly creates this kind of social friction. This is the back door through which you had to walk. But we also worked with spaces like this, which is the Chamber of Commerce, where again we organized the time code so that you could only go and see the parts of the exhibition which were displayed in this building when the kind of Monday to Friday 9 to 5 people were actually there, which also created kind of conversation or kind of relationships between the people that worked there and the audience. This is an example from one of the job centers in Cologne, where Liam Gillick produced this kind of word piece, which was actually installed right on top of the benches where unemployed people are waiting to be called to potentially get a job. And so basically what this project entailed in the end was, you know, rather than producing a kind of new architectural framework in the sense of a kind of iconic and therefore a very expensive physical building, it created a network not only of individuals but also of spaces in Cologne, which could then be used in many different ways over the kind of coming years. So the model, of course, relied heavily on this kind of central core, which was the kind of Trojan horse, but the idea was also that on a, in a kind of longer period, the institution could actually start to inhabit in a kind of parasitical sense other buildings or other institutions, or also travel within a kind of like European geography. So it wouldn't actually be an institution that's bound to the particular locale of Cologne, but it could also go to other places. And we developed five different models of how this could work in terms of a kind of international format. And so one of these models was also a very opportunistic one, which was to link it to the City of Culture, which is this really ridiculous European format where every year there's a kind of City of Culture, which means that they're getting a lot of money from the European Union to basically beef up their kind of cultural institutions. And one way to think about this in a kind of productive way was to basically piggyback onto this phenomenon. We also developed a couple of other kind of spatial models, but this would take us too long now to go through this in much detail. There's a book which was one of the products of this project in the end, which is called Institution Building, and which was exploring like all these different phases of research that we went through. I'm now going to run you through a couple of projects which are going to be much more quick fire. So these last two ones, they took enormously long to actually explain because they were a little bit more complicated. But what I'm going to do now is going back to this kind of idea of cultures of assembly and trying to explain to you a couple of projects and their way of working within, let's say, the studio structure and the kind of umbrella research that we're involved in. So one of these projects was at Manifesta Biennial in Murcia in Spain, which was called Backbench. And it's a setting which probably, if you remember some of the earlier images from the presentation, reminds you of the House of Commons, which was precisely the point. It was an event and a setting that took place before the opening of the Biennial, and which was a kind of stage set for a Turkish filmmaker to produce a documentary about this kind of conference which took place, which was a conference where all the four curatorial collectives of Manifesta actually proposed a group that would represent their kind of, let's say, political intentions. And those were then to be debated in this kind of setting. And the outcome of this debate, which was a documentary film, was supposed to be shown at the Biennale. So we first designed this kind of setting for the discussion to take place, and then later this very setting was displaced, so to speak, from the TV studio into one of the venues of the Biennial, which in this case was the post office in Murcia, or the old post office. But it was doubling not only as a kind of display structure for the actual documentary, but it also acted as a kind of central meeting space for the audience at the Biennial. We've also been involved in a couple of projects which try to deal with this question of proximity that I was trying to explain earlier on when I was talking about the kind of implementation of, for example, an object on the scale of a table in the House of Commons. We've been very interested in how proximity, even to the extent of uncomfortable proximity, can be understood as something that can actually become quite productive. So this is a space in Berlin that we designed for a publishing house and gallery, which is called Archive Cabinet. And it has multiple functions or spaces inside, which I'm not all gonna explain now. I'm just gonna concentrate on this one space, which is the space which, from their point of view, from the point of view of the client, was supposed to be a kind of conference space, as they called it. But it was kind of ridiculous right from the start because it was far too small to actually turn it into a kind of larger discursive space. So we decided to do the exact opposite, which was basically to create a kind of bleacher situation, so this kind of um, how would you call this, a kind of, I guess, like an inverted pyramid, you could say, where the bottom of the pyramid or the leftover space on the ground was so small that you couldn't actually use it in any way. So it's too small to put like two chairs, it's too small to put a table, so it's actually kind of leftover that's unusable, which means that whatever is happening in the space, whether it's a discussion, whether it's a kind of conference setting, whether it's a individual presentation, like a kind of lecture, there's basically no longer a distinction between audience and speakers. So everyone has to sit on this kind of circular bleacher, and the kind of different steps of the bleacher are also designed to wrong proportions, or the proportions don't actually match up with the human body. So it creates a very uncomfortable kind of seating or sitting experience. And usually at these kind of events, they also have quite a large audience, so minimum, I would say, 40 to 50 people. So you can imagine if in the space, I mean, if you look at the scale of, for example, the, I mean, you can hardly see it, but these here, it's like two plugs. So it's actually a very small space, which is only 3.20 meters high. And the bleacher is also going very high up, and it's blocking the window. So basically, we decided there's not going to be any more natural ventilation. And the moment that you have people sitting in this space, let's say 40 people, it gets hot very quickly. So our kind of like working title for the space was the discursive sauna. And the idea was really that you create, through this kind of physical proximity and the kind of discomfort of sitting, a completely different way in which people start to talk to each other. So it also, of course, addresses this kind of situation. Like, for example, now you can see there's someone leaving. So this, of course, happens in almost any kind of conference or social situation like the one that we're in right now. There's always people who are very brave, like you guys, you're sitting in the front, and then there's always the people who are sitting in the back, which, I mean, maybe they're saying that they have a better view, but usually it means also that they have some kind of like exit strategy in mind, which means that if it gets too boring or too long or whatever, they can quickly get out. Which is, of course, fantastic for you, but for these guys who are sitting in there, it became an impossibility because it becomes so kind of uncomfortable, and there's only one way out, which in order to get to this point of actually leaving, you have to go through so many kind of like social micro-conflicts that you're not actually doing it, so everyone's staying in the room. And a kind of similar approach, you could say, was something that we explored in a project in Seoul in Korea with an art institution called Art Sonje, which is it's a very interesting contemporary art institution which only has one, I would say, kind of strange spatial flaw, which is that they have a kind of lecture hall, you could say, which, I mean, it's not even so different from this space. Only that it was designed as a cinema. So there's a kind of cinema owner who runs it, and sometimes if the art institution wants to run discursive events, they also use this space. But it's a very kind of traditional setting of, you know, when they have conferences, there's like one long table, and there's like six people sitting there, and they're all looking at you guys, and there's basically no real dialogue between the people who are supposed to have the dialogue. So one of the things that we proposed to them was to test or to challenge this kind of reality by trying something kind of radically different, which was this kind of little box, which again we call it the discursive sauna, which is basically a kind of concrete box with a kind of setting inside which works like this. And it's just big enough for a kind of group of eight kind of protagonists to sit there. And what we proposed was to completely physically remove the actual protagonists of whatever kind of discursive event is taking place and to plonk them in this structure, which is on the street, and for the audience to be left only with a screen. So in other words, similar to the experience of being in a cinema, which this space was actually designed for. So all of a sudden what's happening is that not only is there like a completely physical rupture, let's say, between audience and protagonists, but also are the protagonists facing a situation in which all of a sudden they're really having to talk to each other. And so with this kind of physical structure, what we also designed was a kind of web interface, which would allow for a kind of different form of audience participation, not only locally, so from the people, for example, who were sitting in the cinema, they could send like text messages, which would then, for example, with questions, which would then be shown on this screen. But also it was possible through a web interface for people internationally to engage with this particular event. So both in terms of like seeing what was going on, but also like posing questions or writing comments. We've also been, in the context of this kind of cultures of assembly, been working on a series of hub typologies over the last couple of years, mostly with Performer Biennial in New York and also Gwangju Biennial in Korea. This was a space that we created for Performer in 2009, which for us was very interesting because they, I mean, for those of you who are not familiar with Performer Biennial, it's a performance art biennial, which is very interesting because it's decentrally organized, so it doesn't have like one or two kind of institutionally representative spaces where all the activities are taking place, but they have roughly like 120 venues, some of them super formal, like, I don't know, the Metropolitan Museum, but some of them also highly informal, like a little project space somewhere or a garden in Queens or whatever. And so their kind of challenge or their problem is that they don't have like one central space, which Rosalie Goldberg, the director in 2009 actually addressed and asked us to come up with kind of space that would deal with this. So one of the things that really interested us in this was that the brief that she gave us was almost impossible because she came up with all these different programs that were supposed to happen in this space. So originally we thought the only way to deal with this was by kind of heavily segregating all the individual programs. But we then decided to do the exact opposite, which was to create a kind of like what we called a kind of bastard typology, which would basically try to do all these different things at once by kind of overlaying them and to have all the different things happening in the same space, which would create kind of constantly a kind of conflictual situation between the different programs. So for example here, you know, you can see people reading. In here it's a kind of radio station, so in here for like the duration of 1 month they were constantly doing like a radio show that was live, consisted of live recordings. They also had a kind of reception booth which was selling all the tickets for the biennial. They had a kind of archive and a bookshop. They had kind of lectures and screenings here and kind of space behind there where other screenings were taking place. So all of this was essentially taking place kind of superimposed on top of each other. And for the 2013 edition of the Performer Hub, we tried to do this in an even more aggressive way, where literally at any one point of the programming of the hub, there were at least six things happening in parallel, which created a somewhat chaotic situation, you could say, but also in that sense, a very urban situation, but on the scale of a kind of interior. So there were people, you know, working, like literally working, like just using the space as a workspace. There were people reading, dealing with the archive, dealing with the library. There were lectures and discursive formats, concerts, and schools. And here, you can see an image from the Gwangju hub, which again tried to deal with this question of how what some people would probably refer to as like wrong design, in the sense that the proportions that are being used are all not really like working with the human body. It's used to create again a kind of mode of discomfort that then turns into a kind of productive mode of dealing with the kind of content that's being displayed and performed in this particular space. One thing that I'm personally very interested in is, are a set of questions concerning architecture and ideology, not only on a kind of like scale of states or kind of in terms of international policy, let's say, but also in on a kind of like smaller scale, which was something that we addressed through a project with the Haus der Kultur in der Welt, which is a it's an art institution in Berlin, which is very interesting in terms of the history of the building because it was a gift by the US government after the Berlin Wall had been built. And they gave like a huge chunk of money for this building to be built in a kind of very, I mean, what you would say, what you would call today a kind of iconic piece of architecture. But it was placed as a kind of political gesture. It was placed right next to the death strip of the Berlin Wall. So the death strip was basically in this part of Berlin where it's placed, which is now the kind of political center. It's a kind of like 200 meter deep zone, which was basically a zone just made up of sand between the two walls. So in case you would try to flee East Berlin, this would give the soldiers the possibility to shoot you while you're running the 200 meters. And so they basically plonked this kind of iconic piece of architecture there as obviously kind of a political statement from the West. And unfortunately, over the decades, the building had been slightly remodeled over and over again. And a couple of years ago, there was a curator who decided that the building would be stripped basically of any kind of spatial changes that were taking place over the years and to use this phase as an opportunity to deal with the question of architecture and ideology in the context of this institution. So so we were basically invited to identify or choose a space of the building that we would like to work with. And we decided to use this space, which is a kind of small kiosk on the roof terrace, which is very interesting because right behind those trees here, it's the chancellery. So it's a huge kind of very intimidating stone building, which it's basically where the chancellor, in kind of current sense, Angela Merkel is residing. So not only working, but also living there. So it's a very interesting spot because there's no other building or no other kind of social space in Berlin where you can get so close to the kind of center of, let's say, political representation. And so what we did was that we used this kind of two-way mirror foil to put onto the glass so that during the day you can't look in, but you can only look out, and the reverse during the night. And we remodeled the interior, which is usually just a pavilion where people are selling beer and where you can buy some snacks, into this kind of like fetish space of architecture and ideology. So the entire space was basically using this red light and only using black latex to cover all the existing surfaces. So you have to imagine when you were when you were stepping into this space, it was basically like opening and smelling a condom. I mean, it was really terrible kind of smell. And it was then kind of showcasing a selection of 50 books, mostly kind of architectural books from the 20th century dealing with architecture and ideology, which were made available as kind of like reading space during the duration of the exhibition. But what was more important was that we were given a certain amount of budget, which we decided that we weren't gonna spend it on kind of architecture, so to speak, or like physical implementation of stuff, but that for the duration of the 5 weeks of the exhibition, we were gonna spend all the budget on programming. So so one thing that we did was that basically every weekend for 72 hours, the space became like a kind of hotspot for different discursive activities, film screenings, concerts, and you have to imagine, I mean, again, well, at least on my screen I can see it, but you can not see it at all here, but you can only see a tiny bit of kind of structure here in the back. So basically this space that you see in the foreground, it just literally sits in front of Angela Merkel's bedroom. I mean, it's completely insane. So it was quite a pleasure for us to be able to, you know, organize like concerts until like 3 a.m. in the morning right outside her bedroom. And one other thing that we were very interested in was this kind of question of how to create this kind of like social dynamic for these very condensed moments in time. So again, here there were also things happening in parallel. So sometimes discussion groups regarding the books, for example, that we identified as relevant in terms of architecture and ideology, sometimes readings or concerts. And again, here, for example, there was a kind of like triple reality of a reading group inside the space, a concert by La Stampa, which is a fantastic band based in Hamburg, and this mural, which was, I mean, you can see it here. It's basically like four people who are putting up live a mural by Simon Fujiwara, who's an artist based in Berlin. And of course, there's especially in East Berlin, I mean, as there is, of course, also in Mexico City, kind of very important history of the mural as a kind of political statement, but also a kind of space where a kind of political conversation can be started. So this mural that in the end was kind of like a 4 by 12 meter mural, again was facing the building of Angela Merkel. We've also been involved over the last couple of years in a couple of projects that we at the studio, we call them revamping projects, which is basically projects that are dealing with institution building in a kind of similar way to what I was addressing earlier in the context of the European Kunsthalle. But in this case here, it was actually addressing the scale of a very localized art institution, Witte de Witte in Rotterdam, and a series of what you could call kind of small scale interventions to try to change quite radically the way in which the institution is being read, especially how it communicates with the public. So this is like part of the front facade that we redid. It's a listed historic building. And we managed, which was actually not so easy, to slightly change the or address the policy of what was formerly a kind of line that would basically continue like this, like filled with this very same kind of brick that the building was built from. So so these guys, as a kind of member of the public, just using this kind of pedestrian area, will actually never be able to look into the building. So there was a complete kind of hermetic situation. So one of the things here that we proposed was to basically cut out these sections and to put in just basically simple sheets of glass that would create a kind of dialogue between the interior of the institution and the kind of public space on the street. We also, in this case, I mean, just so that you don't think that I also have a kind of like architectural or kind of material interest, we can actually also get quite carried away with, let's say, physical design. So what was very interesting for us here in this project was that, I mean, probably most of you know that Rotterdam has quite a big port. And of course, at most ports, there's also a very interesting like steel production industry. So we basically managed to convince one of these kind of local kind of port producers to work with us on this kind of enormous reception, which is basically one block of steel, which weighs 5 tons, and which was became this almost kind of like public event when they moved it into the space, because they needed this huge crane to actually get it from the street into the space. And We also redesigned most of the interior, which partially was to do with, let's say, representative spaces on the ground floor like this, which was a kind of like reading room and archive where they're doing a lot of their educational program. But also for one of the spaces on one of the other floors, they have three floors in the building, we designed a kind of monolith, which is basically a kind of solid block, which consists of 64 L-shaped units, which can be arranged according to the kind of discursive events that they're interested in or that they're playing with and that are, of course, changing over time. There's also one kind of small space that we changed, which for me is the most interesting one, which we call the consensus bar, which in order to understand this space, you need to know that the Witte de Witte as an institution is sharing the building with another art institution, which is called Tent. And basically, these two institutions are really not getting on very well with each other. And what's quite interesting is that on the first floor, both institutions are sharing the floor in terms of their administrative offices. So the only very small space that's kind of left over in between the left, which is Witte de Witte, and the right, which is Tent, is this tiny space with a window. And when the director approached us with this space, she said that she wanted us to consider whether this could be part of the exhibition space, which we thought was a bit strange because it doesn't really have any kind of qualities in terms of kind of display. So instead, what we proposed was to turn this into a bar. But this bar would basically only be open on Friday from 5 to 6 p.m. And it would only be open to people working in the two administrative parts of the institution. And so basically what we also proposed was in this kind of back, kind of almost altar looking like structure, they would place three fridges which were completely stocked with vodka. And so the idea was that every Friday at 5 p.m., the administrative personnel of both institutions basically get wasted together and overcome their kind of insecurities. And at the same time, you would get a kind of, as you can probably not really see in this image, but it's a bit foggy in the image. And there's, we put in like a false ceiling, which has like three kind of industrial standard smoke machines in there that you usually use for like rock concerts. And Witte de Witte has this kind of strange logo, which is a cloud that has never really changed in the last 25 years. And so basically, while the two kind of competing administrative representatives of the institutions are getting drunk together, every 5 minutes there's a cloud that slowly sinks down onto them. A very similar project in terms of this kind of question of institution building and how to deal with institutional spaces as also public spaces is a project that we've done for the Institute of Modern Art in Brisbane in Australia, which is this space. And it's a kind of tiny intervention, you could say. It's basically the what used to be a kind of terrible kind of 90s reception area, very dark and hermetic, where you would basically buy your ticket to see the show and then you would leave. And we basically turned this into a kind of co-working space, which is open to the public, but it also doubles as a library and archive of the institution, but also when there's certain discursive events taking place, it's being turned into a kind of very horizontally organized kind of space for conversation. One kind of aspect that we're also dealing with at the studio is that we're working very closely with a series of artists whom we kind of assist in terms of, let's say, either large-scale spatial projects or in terms of different display strategies. So one of the artists that we've been working with constantly over the last 4 years is a German filmmaker called Tito Steyer. And for her, we've been basically designing all the shows in the last 3 years. And what was quite interesting for us was that we've been kind of granted this, let's say, freedom or kind of certain possibility of creating spatial frameworks that, you know, weren't kind of dictated, so to speak, from the point of view of a kind of client, so to speak, coming to you, giving you a brief, and then you're becoming a kind of service provider for an idea that already exists, but basically just facing us with the actual product, which in her case is always the kind of films that she's producing, and then to actually come up with very different display strategies for these individual works. So this image that you see here, it's an image from one fairly recent show at Artist Space in New York, where we've been further developing a kind of typology or display typology which we originally invented for her first major retrospective at the Van Abbe Museum in Eindhoven. And it's basically a quarter pipe, like some of you may know from skateboarding. But the idea was to basically displace this or misplace this in the context of kind of art institution, but purely in terms of kind of comfort of viewing, because some of her films really are quite long. I mean, basically too long to just kind of walk through an exhibition space. This is an image from the actual retrospective at Van Abbe, which was very interesting because it basically consisted of 13 film works. And basically each space, so in it's a very big museum, and basically each space of the museum was dedicated to one film. And so each space was then designed as a kind of specific spatial response to the film that Tito had produced. I'm not going to talk about the individual images for too long because this would we've already been running, I think, for quite some time. This is a work that's, I mean, very kind of tiny in terms of its, let's say, physical existence as a kind of structure that sits in the space. But it was very interesting for us to develop this with her. It's called Adorno's Gray. And the film is very interesting because it deals basically with Adorno and specifically his last lecture at Goethe University in Frankfurt. And there's this kind of rumor or this kind of myth that when Adorno first got his professorship at the Goethe University, that he went to the dean of the school and he told them that he's only going to teach spaces which are going to be painted in a particular kind of gray, which then was actually done. But there was, because of course this is all like, you know, half a century ago, there have been lots of changes ever since to the institution. So basically Hito's project was to do a documentary about a series of these kind of, how do you call them, these people that reconstruct old churches, you know, that get like the old drawings out again. Like a kind of restoration. So she basically worked with four of these restorators to go into these individual lecture spaces and basically try to like find this kind of tone, particular kind of tone of gray, which she titled Adorno's Gray, which was then part of this exhibition also. Okay, for those of you who are already super tired and slightly annoyed that I've been going on for so long, there is hope, because we're almost at the end. This project is a project that, for me personally, it's super important because it unites many of my, not only personal interests, but also the research kind of interests that I've been working on basically for the last 10 years. It's a very strange project politically and spatially, which is basically the result of the end of the Cold War, where basically the American military used to have a kind of basically unknown set of bunkers, which are very roughly located between Frankfurt and Cologne in Germany, in an area which is very hilly and mostly uninhabited, with very dense forest. And they've basically used it as a place to store nuclear warheads, which neither the local population nor the German population was aware of. So what you can see here is one of the kind of drawings from the time that this kind of military base was built. And this section of the site was used to store the American warheads, the nuclear warheads. And this part of the site, which was known as the German sector, was also consisted of all these individual bunkers, but those were used to store the actual missile systems, which in case of a nuclear fallout with the Soviet Union would have been, you know, driven down to the gate, and the warheads been driven down to the gate, because obviously after the Second World War there was a complete kind of impossibility to imagine this kind of together. They would have assembled the missile system here, and they would have driven it to a launch pad very close nearby. So what's very strange about this is that if you look at this from Google Earth, you know, you would think that if someone's coming up with this idea to store nuclear warheads in the middle of nowhere so that they're not being detected, you would be a little bit more careful in terms of the kind of like satellite footprint that you're leaving. But they basically cut like the entire tree line, and they just created this kind of you know, space the size of like 20 football pitches, soccer pitches. And so what was very interesting, what happened after the fall of the Berlin Wall, was that the Americans no longer really considered there to be a kind of serious kind of threat of a kind of like nuclear armed Soviet Union, which of course was also falling apart. So they decided to abandon the program. They removed the nuclear warheads in the forest, just like jogging. And at some point he saw like behind a tree line like some what looked like gates, but he didn't know what it was, so he walked over there and he climbed it, and then all of a sudden he kind of found himself in this kind of like strange kind of environment made up of bunkers and like concrete roads in the middle of nowhere. And after like some kind of like research and investigation on what was going on there in the kind of second half of the 20th century, and a kind of ambition to maybe think about this space as what could theoretically become a kind of cultural center, he approached the government, and he managed to buy, or basically to lease the site for 99 years of the government for €1, which may sound kind of odd to you, that this kind of like €1 strategy, but in Germany it's quite a kind of common thing to happen if there's certain like government sites that the government no longer cares about or doesn't want to take care of. They basically give it away very cheaply, but with a condition that whoever buys it for €1 actually has to take care of it. So so this was 7 years ago. And basically since then, there has already been a phase of kind of slow renovation of the existing bunkers, which are already at the moment being used for kind of temporary exhibitions, but they can only take place at the moment in the summer. This is one of the bigger bunkers. This is one where they store the nuclear warheads, where we've, you know, designed like temporary shows and stuff like that. But one of the big issues that they're facing now is that, or that they've been facing for a couple of years, and that we've been engaged with together with them in for the last 3 years, is to come up actually with a kind of long-term proposal that not only deals with the existing spaces, but also the landscape and potentially like two new spaces, which would include a kind of residency program for up to 5 artists and a kind of display space, which would actually be overground, because all the other spaces, they're kind of like semi-hidden. And when they approached us, it was super interesting for us, because they were actually, they had like very little experience with running an art institution, but they were very ambitious, but at the same time, they were also aware that there was this kind of lack of experience, and that they really wanted to work with, let's say, a studio that could, you know, hopefully maybe challenge a kind of, let's say, normative architectural project from the point of view of only, in inverted commas, being able to deal with the spatial or physical changes of the existing or the forthcoming new architecture, but also, I mean, to deal with the institution almost as a kind of full institutional package. So what we're doing with them is that we're also working very closely with them on curatorial strategies. We're working with them on different kind of PR strategies. We're designing the kind of publication program for them. We're, of course, also dealing with the spaces. But the way that we're doing this is through a kind of time code that's based on three phases, of which each phase is 5 years long. So right now we're in the first phase, which is going to end in 2 years. And then the second phase will be the one which will see most of the kind of spatial changes on the site. And the third phase will be the one where there will actually be kind of new build also going on. So in many ways, this for us really combines like a lot of the kind of aspects that in terms of the research we've been exploring over the past couple of years, and that really for us, it's also a very interesting question of how that as a kind of practice can then start to maybe inform or challenge certain questions of responsibility, and how your practice as an architect can also, I mean, not only assume other kind of realities that may be going beyond the kind of physical reality of architecture, but also how it can start to maybe hijack or displace the kind of role models that we're used to. Thank you very much. I hope you haven't fallen asleep yet.
Hello. Well, of course, all the examples are quite inspiring, because most of them, without the participation of the architect and of the one with the people and with the open minds that can clearly arrange new typologies of architecture, it would be less possible to do this project. So it's I'm glad to see this kind of new ideas and of typology. So I would like to thank Marcus, but before that, do you have any questions? ¿Alguna pregunta, chicos?
Yeah, you were really behaving very well, being very quiet in the back especially. At least you didn't perform your exit strategy. That's good. Well, Norma did a couple of times, but now you're back.
One of the ideas of bringing Marcus to this school, architecture school, was to do a workshop, which was partially we did in our workshop in El Taller Max Cheto. We did a workshop with the students having an installation with the desks that you use always in the classrooms to design, and we did an installation in the Academia de San Carlos to create a provoke an idea of participation to bring the idea of bringing outside the school walls, the desk of where you design or the architect design the main ideas of the city, of the architecture in the cities, to bring it to the city, to outside the walls. So it was a nice exploration with the ideas of the book of Marcus Meessen. So hopefully we can do it again.
Yeah, sure, that would be fantastic.
So any questions? Boys, girls? You're tired.
Okay, well, that I can understand. So maybe, I mean, I don't know, it's difficult to pose a question at the kind of group, but maybe I can pose it to you in terms of maybe the kind of role models that you're working with or exploring at the school. I mean, maybe you can say a little bit about, how you would like to see, for example, the moment that students are leaving the school, like after their degree, like which kind of directions they would go into. I mean, this can of course be very multifaceted also, but mm-hmm. what's the kind of ambition of the school there in terms of this development?
Well, it is quite wide, the all the roles that many people goes. There are many young architects that goes to strong offices, big offices of design. Some others go to start their work in the government, in public offices. And the others are like own their private activities. Some other design pieces or building and supervision construction sites. There are many areas where the school is working. But one interesting idea is that some students of this school are. We work with some the government, the city government is working with the budget of public budget to do a participation project. So. It is not worthy, not wealthy, but there are ideas of some areas in the neighborhoods that they work with an idea, for example, to do a design to put better images or public furniture in the parks or in the corners or in the streets. Or lighting, in general cases. So one project, a pair of students of us, they work in the idea of helping the neighbors before, and they deal with all the process of this application of the budget, and from scratch to do it. And
oh,
helping
fantastic.
the citizens. So it was quite.
So it's something that then is being developed at the university and it's actually being implemented?
Exactly.
Yes. Ah, that's really fantastic.
So that, it's actually the girls are still finishing their studies.
Okay.
So it's very wide.
Yeah. I mean, actually, I think it's also very interesting what you're saying about. You know, students who have graduated also, for example, moving into government office. Mm-hmm. Because that's, for example, something like if I compare this to Germany, I mean, I would say one of the really serious shortcomings in terms of like public policy is that if you go to the kind of ministry that's dealing with like urban questions, mm-hmm. like most of the people who work there, they have neither studied architecture nor urbanism, nor have any kind of real kind of let's say challenging mode of thinking when it comes to like spatial questions.
Yeah.
But of course, I mean, as I tried to also say earlier, I think there's a real kind of necessity also for architects to understand that policy, it's a kind of fantastic and really kind of, I mean, also complex but very strong way to affect, of course, spatial reality. So I mean, most of the kind of urban reality that we're moving inside of, it's, I mean, I would say that at least policy is as important as the kind of physical designs that then start to occur on a kind of smaller scale, but they're all working, they all have to work within the framework of that policy. I mean, some are more, let's say, I would say some architects are becoming like slaves of the policy, mm-hmm. and then there's maybe others who are trying to challenge it, but regardless of that, at the end of the day, you still have to have some kind of opinion and have to somehow work around it. And I think for that kind of framework to exist and for those frameworks to be challenged, I think this is a fantastic way to yeah. also introduce and to also foster an interest in students that, you know, policy can also be something that's not like super boring, but something that
yeah.
can be something that has like a huge impact.
Yes, exactly. In terms of less, more administrative process, and designing with it and dealing with that and solve problems and having the ideas to work with the city in not in terms of show off results, in terms of giving a service to the community. So it's a seed that is growing bit by bit.
Yeah, and I mean it's also super interesting to understand that actually like writing a document, like designing a text, is of course also design. I mean, I really, for example, enjoy with something that sounds like super boring, which is to like write contracts, because I mean there's like each line of a contract. I mean, I can become like totally nerdy about this, but like to really like go into the details, like the legal details of a contract, yeah. and how you can expand and challenge certain realities just by putting sometimes like a single word.
Exactly.
And of course, this kind of like, a very happy moment when you realize that the person at the other end of the table didn't realize what this simple word means. I think it can be quite interesting.
Yeah.
So,
I would like to thank Markus Miesen from Germany to attending this this conference. So in representance of the Dean, Markus Massari, I give you the acknowledgement to come from to the university. And one of the last books that was edited by the university, by the architecture school.
Fantastic, thank you.
To have a look after 60 years of the university, how it looks now. All the buildings and all the campus that we are living every day.
Thank you so much. That's very kind of you.
Okay,
cool.
Thank you.
Thank you. And thank you all for coming.